Next, they lost the original opening verse.
Friday night and the lights are low, which is a verse from much later in the song. They took that and moved it to the start because that's where it should be.
Friday night and the lights are low. It's so perfect because it puts you in a time and a place and a mood.
You're a teaser, you turn him on. Leave him burning and then you're gone. Looking out for another, anyone will do. You're in the mood for a dance. And when you get the chance,
you are the dance.
When they're singing in unison, it almost sounds like one voice that's been chorused.
It's a really unique technique that ABBA exploit really, really well. It's really rare in pop music for two voices to sing the same thing.
It's a very special sound. It's a third sound that comes out. It tickles the hairs of the ear.
Dancing Queen had taken 6 months to perfect. ABBA were pushing for its release, but another track lying on the shelf was manager Stig Anderson's preference.
The snare drums.
Can you hear the drums, Fernando?
Stig Anderson said, well, it's got to be Fernando. You know, that's a surefire hit.
It's cute, it's great, it's catchy, but it harkens back to that schlager music sound, which is just a little naff and a little goofy.
He knew, well, it might be old-fashioned, but, you know, everyone's going to love it. It's going to appeal to very young children. It's going to appeal to grandmothers and everyone in between.
In March 1976, Fernando was released in the UK.
Fernando and Dancing Queen couldn't be further apart if they tried, could they? Such different sounds, different sentiments.
Dancing Queen, I think, is just hipper.
Benny finally got his way. On the 27th of August, 1976, Dancing Queen was released.
Yay, 1976, summer, the sun comes out, and Dancing Queen comes out. And that was just the cherry on top of the icing, on top of the cake of sunshine. It just was the perfect sunshiny soundtrack.
It makes you happy the first 10 seconds you hear it. It's like they put some instinct in it. It's voodoo or mojo or whatever.
Listen to the rhythm, how it's composed. It's absolutely magnificent.
Dancing Queen is just musical serotonin. It's just pure joyfulness. It's ecstatic.
Dancing Queen knocked Elton John and Kiki Dee off the top spot. It became the group's third UK number one in a row.
It's easy to name the countries where it wasn't number one.
Queen, young and sweet, only 17.
Dancing Queen was probably the song that really showed to the world that there's no one to compete with them, really, in terms of creating catchy pop music.
It's not pop music, it's not rock music, it's ABBA.
In January 1977, Dancing Queen was released in the US. It took 7 weeks to crack the top 40, 12 to crack the top 10.
The US is a difficult market to crack. Having a number one in America isn't an overnight thing. It might take weeks, it could take months.
Las Vegas and New York, they were the two very special. Not so many fans, but more curious people who were thinking, well, what is this phenomenon?
It was made a hit through being played in the clubs rather than on the radio, which is normally the way to get a hit in the United States.
Finally, in April 1977, Dancing Queen went to number one in the US Billboard chart.
Dancing Queen was the only single that gave ABBA that all-important US number one.
There was no question that ABBA were now, you know, among the hugest acts on the planet.
In the wake of Dancing Queen, ABBA embarked on a world tour starting in Europe.
In the UK, they had 11,000 tickets to sell at the Royal Albert Hall, and 3.5 million people applied for tickets.
Despite their success, nothing would prepare them for their reception in Australia.
The entire nation was caught up in this ABBA frenzy, this ABBA fever, this ABBA mania, as it was called. Everything was just chaos and completely wonderful at the same time.
But sadly, this euphoria was not set to last. As the years ticked by, the pressure on the band would become impossible to bear.
What we would have no understanding of is the pressure that they must have been on together, working together, touring together, performing together, and then having a private life together. We thought we knew them, but we didn't really.
This pressure resulted in both couples splitting. First, Agnetha and Björn, followed soon after by Frida and Benny. The ending of the two couples' relationships would inspire what many, including Agnetha, considered to be their best ever track and the greatest breakup song of all time, The Winner Takes It All.
I don't wanna talk about things we've gone through, though it's hurting me. Now it's history.
By 1980, 8 years after they began, ABBA had become the biggest hit machine on the planet. As they drew on inspiration for their next album, drama was unfolding in their personal lives.
In January of 1980, Björn and Benny went abroad. They went to Barbados. Benny had been there a couple of years earlier, and he had been invited by Paul McCartney and his wife Linda to this house. Benny remembered that house. You know, we should go there. It was really nice. We could go there and try to write some songs. It'll be a change of scene. That week of songwriting in Barbados was, you know, fairly productive, so they were in very good shape when they started recording sessions for the Supertrooper album.
On the 9th of June 1980, at the peak of ABBA's fame, Björn and Agnetha's 9-year marriage had come to an end.
ABBA were global superstars, two of our favorite couples, but they had something accessible about them. We felt we knew them.
When Agnetha and Björn announced that they were getting a divorce, that sent shockwaves through the ABBA universe, because you're thinking, well, you've got these two cute, wholesome couples and their whole brand is built on them being cute couples.
I think when Björn and Agnetha actually separated and they divorced, I'm sure people were disappointed because it was the fairy tale. That's the whole thing, the two couples together laughing, joking. Everyone felt they were on a journey with them.